Hi everyone and welcome to AXA Coral Live. It's amazing to have you all with us, and today is a fantastic lesson. It is an introduction to the coral ecosystem and specifically for older students. So we're going to get right into the nitty-gritty of coral science. And before we get started, I can see that we have an amazing array of schools signed up and joining us. We have a big shout out, a bienvenue and welcome to students watching from the Lycée Français Charles de Gaulle, and that's in London. Don't forget also that tomorrow morning, afternoon at 12:30, we have a lesson in French. As part of AXA Coral Live, so do join us for that as well. A big good afternoon to all the students watching at King Edward VI College, and a big welcome to Stoke Sixth Form, who are watching from Staffordshire. And I think we can connect now all the way to the Kamabi Research Station in Curaçao. And Michelle, can you hear me?
Yes, definitely. Loud and clear. Hello, everyone. Welcome.
Thanks so much. Sorry, thanks so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure. I'd like to welcome you all to the Kamabi Education Centre. So this is our little exhibit at the research station here on Curaçao in the Southern Caribbean.
Amazing. And we've got a great lesson coming up. Just a few quick notes on interaction. So please do send us your questions, and you can do that in two ways. You can use the YouTube live chat, and you'll need to be signed into YouTube for that. That's the bar on the side of the screen here, if you're not in full screen. You can always use a secondary device to send through questions. So looking forward to seeing those come through. Those will be sent to myself and Michelle, and that's by Sim, who is moderating at the moment. So if you see those messages popping up, that's what's happening there. You can also use the live chat option on the Encounter EDU website, encounteredu.com, and you'll see in the bottom right-hand corner there's a sort of white speech bubble. Click on that, and you'll get through to us too. Now, there's two types of questions you may have. First of all, are questions of clarification. So if there's a term that is used, or you want a little bit further information or clarification of something, do pop a question in and we will answer it as part of the general talk. But if there are sort of wider questions or broader questions, we will keep those to the end when we have our sort of Q&A section at the end of this session. But wonderful, Michelle, to have you with us. And before we start, you've mentioned that you're at a research station, and fingers crossed, that's where some of the watching students will be in the years to come. What is a research station, and how come you're based there?
Yeah, so a research center is a facility which has labs and rooms and accommodation for researchers. It has aquaria where we can keep marine animals if necessary, and it has also everything that is necessary to enable divers to get into the water. So the research station I'm at on Curaçao, it's a quite old station. It's been established already as one of the best stations in the Caribbean. So anything you need to do here in terms of marine biology research can be done. And yeah, we'd be more than happy to welcome any of you in the future if you decide to study marine biology, or maybe you want to try out diving or anything like that.
And it's situated close to the reef. I mean, you know, how far would you have to walk / swim to get to the coral reef from where you are at the moment?
Yeah, so we're really close to the coral reef. So the research station is built right on the beach. So it would be a matter of just walking to the shoreline. What would that be? I'm looking that way because that's where the door is, roughly 50 to 100 meters. And you just jump in and then swim roughly 30 meters and you would get to where the reef starts dropping off.
Amazing. So, so close to the environment that you're studying. And Michelle, you haven't always been based at Carmarthen. Your research career has taken you around the world. What have you been studying and where?
Yeah, so I've been moving between a few countries indeed. So from Greece to the Netherlands, Australia, and now Curaçao. In Australia, I was working on the Great Barrier Reef. And I've been studying mostly sponges and a very specific type of sponges that I will talk to you in more detail about soon, if you like.
Brilliant. So sponges around the world. And you mentioned sponges there, and we're talking about coral, the coral ecosystem for this sort of live lesson. There's a couple of animals that our viewers should be familiar with before we get started, and perhaps you can introduce us to those two animals before we get into the sort of lesson proper.
Definitely. So I can actually show you, I have here some coral skeletons, and I'll explain you what exactly you're looking at. So both of these corals are from the reefs of Curaçao. This one is what we call a brain coral, and that's clearly because of, you know, the shape that it has. It really resembles a brain, as you can see. And so what you're seeing here is a skeleton which the coral has been building over years and years. Now the coral obviously is dead, but if it was to be alive, you would see a fleshy tissue here on the surface. Now that's all gone, and you can see the skeleton that has remained underneath. Same for this one. And here I also want to show you, you see all these little holes? So those, they each belong to one individual coral polyp, as we call them. These polyps are individual little animals, but they live all together, forming this bigger coral colony. So corals are colonial organisms. And that is sort of different from what sponges are. I also have here some sponges to show you. So here's again what is left of a sponge that once used to live on the reefs of Curaçao. And if I turn it a bit, you can see these tubes, which is really actually characteristic of sponges. So sponges are filter feeders. So the water gets sucked into the bottom of the sponge and it comes out through these individual tubes, having filtered out whatever is of nutritional value to them, having kept the oxygen so that they can breathe. And what I also want you to notice is that this structure is really fragile and it's not hard at all, like the coral skeleton you saw earlier. So when sponges die, typically, you know, we took this one out and sort of saved the structure, but underwater this would slowly dissolve away and there'd be nothing left, whereas the coral skeleton will take years and years to dissolve and disappear.
And I guess, Michelle, that's why we call it the coral ecosystem rather than the sponge ecosystem, that the coral structure persisting for decades, centuries, if not longer.
Exactly, because those structures are exactly what form coral reefs, actually. So other organisms will continue to grow on those structures, other corals will settle on them, as in start growing on them and become bigger and bigger. And so this is really a living structure as well as a dead structure, but together it really forms the framework of coral reefs.
And you mentioned that just sort of 100 meters through that door with a walk and a swim and a splash, that you would be, you know, you'd be on the coral reef and found in the rather wonderful tropical island that you find yourself. Is it only Curacao, or do we find sort of tropical reefs all across the world, or where do we find them?
Yeah, so we find them in many places, but definitely not all across the world. So if you look at the global distribution of coral reefs, so where on the planet do we find them? You will notice that it's really sort of a zone flanking the equator. So we have coral reefs a bit north of the equator, a bit south of the equator, but there is really this strong relationship between water temperature, basically, and coral reefs. So, yeah, we have coral reefs. I mentioned the Great Barrier Reef of Australia. We have lots of coral reefs in the Pacific Ocean, many small islands or bigger ones. So, for example, think of Hawaii or Fiji or New Caledonia. And then we also have, of course, the Caribbean Basin, where Curaçao also belongs to.
And I mean, just a small point that there are, we're talking about a specific type of coral reef, because we do have coral reefs here in the UK that they're slightly different. They're deeper, and I think sort of for those watching, Mingalay and on the Outer Hebrides is a famous one. But you know, what's the difference between the reefs that you're talking about and the wider sort of corals around the world?
Yeah, so the reefs I'm talking about are really what we call the tropical coral reefs. So they are reefs in shallow, warm waters where corals really depend on sunlight. And that's because corals are, they're sort of a plant and an animal two in one, you could say. So they have these symbiotic microorganisms inside their body. These microorganisms are photosynthetic. So they produce a lot of sugars. They share a lot of this energy with the coral, apart from feeding themselves. And so this really makes this type of corals dependent on sunlight, which is often also results also in warm waters. Now, corals also exist indeed in deeper or colder waters. Some of these do not necessarily depend so much on this type of symbionts, but they feed themselves actually by grabbing little particles out of the water. They have these little tentacles that they use as their feeding appendages.
And just to clarify that term you use, symbiont, may not be a term that everyone's come across.
Yeah, so symbiont comes from Greek, actually. So it's from syn, which means plus, and bio, which means life. So it means something that lives together with something else. So that's the plus in the word. And so these organisms, you know, they're not like a bacteria that might infect you. It's more like a bacteria that will live inside your body without causing any disease, without having negative effects on you, but actually having positive effects. And so you're living together with that microorganism.
Amazing. And you know, we were chatting before and you mentioned that the tropical coral animal that makes up the reef is quite fussy. Can you describe its fussiness and why we don't find it sort of all over the world?
Yeah, so corals are indeed quite picky when it comes to the conditions that they like to live in. So we already talked about one thing, which is the water temperature, right? So they really prefer water temperatures between 23 to 29 or 30 degrees Celsius. We do see corals also in lower temperatures, so down to 18 degrees. But really the best range for them is that warmer range. So that's one thing. Another thing that they're really picky about is the water quality in which they are. So for the sunlight to be able to penetrate and reach them, the water has to be really clear. So turbid waters are not good for corals. You know, the typical brown water that you would see at a river mouth, that's not good for corals. Then there is also the salinity of the water. So corals are found in salty water, and there's a range of salinity that they are adapted to as well. What else? Am I missing something there, Jamie?
No, I think we've got the temperature, we've got the salinity there, we've got the, I mean, we've talked on the side a little bit about depth in relation to sunlight, because of course, you know, that as you know, sunlight travels through water, it's absorbed, for want of a better word, and so you want it quite shallow to get that sort of, you know, that solar power for the photosynthesis in the symbiont in that algae, probably often sort of near shore, so not sort of randomly in the middle of the ocean, but you know, growing on something. I think we've got it covered.
Exactly.
And I mean, this going on, you know, near shore, that we don't have. You know, if we look at that map, we don't have corals in the middle of the ocean, just sort of freely doing their thing. That there's a connection between geology and the formation of coral reefs, and that connection between that sort of that individual sort of, you know, coral skeleton that you've shown, and this idea of the reef that, you know, we have from watching nature documentaries or from tourist brochures of the Great Barrier Reef. What is that link between geology and the coral ecosystem?
Yeah, so there's definitely a strong link there. And so like Jamie said, imagine you're in the middle of the Pacific. It's very deep. You can't even see the sea bottom. So corals there cannot see the sunlight, right? So it's way too deep for them to grow. But if you have an abrupt geological event, such as a volcano forming on the bottom of the sea, this might result in an island. So you might be familiar with how volcanic islands are formed. And so imagine the sea bottom sort of gets pushed up. And if this is here, let's say the water level, an island forms, right? Because my fingers are above that level. And so what you see here sometimes happening is that, you know, all around these edges here, all around these fringes, it's really shallow suddenly, right? So the sunlight reaches here. And so corals are able to grow here. And if they do happen to settle, so if they do, if larvae of corals, so tiny baby corals that swim freely through the ocean, if they happen to reach the surface, they will start growing and then they will multiply, and slowly, slowly you will see a reef form and it will go all around that island. And that's what we call a fringing reef, because it grows all around the fringes of an island. Now, what can also happen, and this is what has happened on the Great Barrier Reef of Australia, is that as ocean levels change, which happens between millennia and which happens when there's an ice age and all these larger global events, some of these shallower areas and the land that has formed might get flooded again. And so imagine that happening, and then, you know, my fingers are getting more and more submerged. So you are losing most of that island. If some of the island still remains, the reef now is here instead of here. And so what happens is that we've increased, or the distance has increased between where the reef formed and the island. And so we call that a barrier reef. So if you want to access a barrier reef, you can't just jump into the water on the island. You need to take a boat and go further out on the Great Barrier Reef. You might have to travel for an hour before you get to the coral reef. And then the third option, so we've talked about two ways of how coral reefs might form. Now we have a third way that coral reefs might form, and that's when this island gets completely submerged, And the coral that was growing on the fringes still remains. So we end up having a completely submerged island, but we still have this ring of coral reefs, and that's what we call a coral atoll.
Amazing. And of those three, what's happened on Curaçao?
Yeah, so on Curaçao, we have a typical fringing reef. So we have a reef, coral reef, all along the southern western side of the island. And we would have coral reefs also on the north, was it not for the sea conditions in the north. So in the north, the wave action is really high. We get really stormy waters. And that type of conditions are okay for a few corals, and we do find those there, but they're not good enough for these huge reefs to form like we see on the south coast, which is more sheltered and protected.
And if we were, I've seen these amazing sort of aerial and sometimes satellite sort of imagery of the reef. If we were to take fly a drone, out from the shoreline just beside you and fly it sort of over the shore and there's maybe a sort of 50, 100 meters out, what will we see and how would this relate to this coral reef formation?
Yeah, so we would see many different colours. So we would start closest to shore with these beautiful turquoise waters. So basically what happens there is we have a sandy bottom and it's beautiful white sand because it has formed from the breaking down of corals over hundreds of years. So the light reflects there really nicely and we have this beautiful, really light blue zone. And then if we go a little bit further from shore, we start seeing these patches of darkness. And these are actually the first coral colonies that we see. And so these will typically start growing here in Curaçao between, I'd say, roughly around 5 meters depth and up to 8 meters depth. We will see what we call our shallow corals. And they are typically big, sturdy, branchy forms, or some rounder forms, but anyway, you would see those through the drone. And then if you went even deeper, it becomes darker and darker. So you still see the blue water, but now it's much darker. And that's because underneath now, we actually have a coral reef starting to form. So here on Curaçao, from 8 to roughly 15 or 20 meters, we have the intermediate zone. Where we have a lot of really what we call massive corals. This refers to their size, but mostly to their growth form. So it's really like the corals I showed you earlier, they're these massive boulders. So you would see those as well from the drone. And then we're going even deeper. So now it becomes harder to see any of this from the surface. But the reef starts really sloping down abruptly, I would say, all the way down to 60 meters. And here we have a completely different form of corals growing. And these are plating corals. So they really look like little solar panels, actually.
Amazing. So I've got the sort of branching coral, I've got the sort of massive or boulder type corals, and then the plate corals further down on the reef. And we come on to this idea of reef zones, and there's some technical terms that we give to these different zones on the reef. If you could just maybe take us through the sort of main reef zones and how the conditions in those zones affect the type of coral you might find.
Exactly. So I'll start just continuing with those plating corals. So they are in what we call the deeper zone of the reef. So like I said, here on Curaçao, that would be from roughly 20 to 60 meters depth. And then below 60 meters, you really get, you get this the ocean abyss, let's say. So it becomes really deep there. Now, in the zone between 20 and 60 meters, like I said, we have these plating corals. And they have that form because they really depend on trapping as much sunlight as they can. So down in those depths, it actually becomes quite gloomy and dark, and there's not that much sunlight. So by having that form, it sort of secures for them that whatever light is there, they are going to trap it. Now, if we come a bit shallower, so we move into that zone where we have the bigger, bolder corals. So here we see forms that are really resilient to storms, resilient to wave action. So they do really well in that zone. And then if we go even shallower, we see branching corals. And these, you might think, well, aren't they really fragile to storms and waves when they are in that shallow zone? To some extent they are, even though their branches are really sturdy. But part of how they reproduce and spread on the reef also has to do with storms. So the small piece happens to break off and it falls elsewhere where the conditions are favourable, it can grow and start growing a new coral colony.
And so we've got two main sort of like factors. We've got depth, which affects sunlight, available sunlight, and then we've got wave action. And there's two different strategies that seems to deal with wave action. One is to be a boulder, and if you got strong, and one is to be branching. And if you do break off, then you can sort of regrow happily, sort of, you know, next door to where you were. Is that about right?
Yeah, that's right. And those branching corals, we actually call them the weeds of the coral reef, because most corals grow really slowly. But these corals have evolved to grow fast because they do have a lot of damage when there is a storm. And so the faster they can grow back, the better. So, yeah, we call those the weeds of the coral reef.
And is that, you know, we're talking about Curaçao here. Is that a similar sort of like range of sort of coral zones that you'd find on somewhere like the Great Barrier Reef as well?
Yeah, so you would find zones on most coral reefs. The depths of each zone will be slightly different, perhaps, because this really depends on the local light conditions, on the local water clarity, which will allow light to penetrate deeper or more shallow. But yeah, you do see zonation on a lot of reefs around the world.
And you talk about weeds and you talk about fast growing. I mean, fast growing weeds for me is sort of several sort of meters a year when I think about terrestrial plants, both for sort of branching coral and for those specimens of coral skeletons you had. What kind of speed are we talking about here?
Yeah, so the speed is much smaller, even for the ones we call weedy. So for the corals we call weedy, we could imagine that there's a growth of roughly 5 to 10 centimeters a year. So really much slower than the weeds in your garden that you have to sort of weekly pull them out, right? And then these slower growing corals, like these bolder types, they might only grow like a few centimeters, perhaps even millimeters per year, depending also on their own age. So when they're young, they tend to grow faster, because they still want to grow, and there's a high growth rate in a young age. But when they grow bigger, they've sort of, you know, they've accomplished a big enough size to be able to feed themselves properly and to compete with other organisms on the reef, and then their growth rate typically drops.
And we started off this live lesson by talking about the coral ecosystem and not just the formation of the coral reef, the structure by the coral animal itself. What is the relationship between the coral animal and the structures it makes, and then the sort of what I've heard is the great biodiversity supported by coral?
Exactly. So that's a really important thing on coral reefs. So in coral reef ecology, we talk about the structural complexity of coral reefs. So this term really refers to that three-dimensionality of a coral reef. So you can imagine all these structures next to each other, like buildings in a city, basically. Within those structures, other organisms can hide, other organisms can grow. So the corals really create this framework that will enable other organisms to come and live there.
And there's a term that's escaped me, which is what you sort of almost lay a sort of string along the top of a structure to work out its complexity. I can remember snorkeling in with a group in the Bahamas looking at this. Remind me of the term.
Yeah, that's called the rugosity of a coral reef.
There we go.
So basically, if you imagine you have a piece of rope, and you know you're stretching it out between these two points, and let's say that's 15 centimeters, but if there's a coral growing right here, and you stretch out that same line over that exact distance, you won't have enough line. You need a longer rope because the coral makes the distance between those two points. If you take the line distance and wrap it around the coral, it makes that distance bigger. And so the bigger that distance that becomes, the more three-dimensionality we have in the reef. So, you know, comparing a flat surface with just a sandy bottom where there's nowhere to hide, there's nowhere to grow on, and comparing that to the three-dimensionality that corals add, it's quite easy to see why corals enable this really biodiverse ecosystem.
And apart from something like sort of 700, 800 tropical coral species, tell me a little bit more about the amazing life that the coral reef supports.
Yeah, so if you go on a dive, the first thing you'll notice on a coral reef is the fish. The fish, because they're moving all over the place. So there's so many different types of fish. They're beautiful, they're colorful. And we have all types of sizes of fish as well. So because the coral reef had this structure, there's always the little fish that hide inside the corals. But then that means there's a lot of food for the slightly bigger fish. And that means there's food for the even bigger fish. And so you really create this whole food chain, leading in the most healthy coral reefs, leading all the way up to sharks. So the fish is one thing. The other thing you will see is all different types of invertebrates. So ranging from mollusks, which include stuff like sea slugs, sea snails, octopus, squid. You will see things like underwater worms, polychaetes, we call them, Christmas tree worms, which have like a feathery appendage which allows them to catch oxygen from the water. You'll see turtles. Yeah, there's so much to talk about, really.
So much, and be amazing to spend time with that. I'm just going to move us on to some of the sort of nitty-gritty things that students might come up against in exams, or just to deepen their sort of understanding of ecosystem science, almost rather than sort of the natural history side. So you see so many specimens behind you. But sort of what are the factors that we need to think about in terms of the functioning of the coral ecosystem?
Yeah, so here we really talk about two very different groups of factors. So on the one hand, we have the biotic factors, and that term really refers to anything that is living on a coral reef. So we just talked about some examples of what that type of organisms would be. And so they interact with each other, they feed on each other, they compete with each other and whatnot, but they also interact with a whole different group of factors, which we call abiotic factors. And so these are not things that are alive, these are physical environmental factors, such as, for example, we talked about temperature, we talked about light, we have nutrients in the water column that are really important for the survival of all these organisms. So the interaction between these abiotic, or I said on this side, the biotic and abiotic factors is what forms a coral reef ecosystem.
And we do have diagrams for that, and they are included in a downloadable slideshow for this lesson. So don't worry if you haven't been able to note down all the wonderful nuggets of information that Michelle's been giving you. There is a sort of revision slideshow attached. I'm sorry if I didn't mention that before. I mean, but we're talking about, you know, we've got sunlight and that goes to the producers, including the symbionts inside the coral and the seagrass and other things we've got, to nutrients. You talk a little bit about sort of nitrates and phosphates that you might sort of experience in a terrestrial sort of ecosystem. But we've also, we've got the biotic systems, we've got the sort of producers, consumers, you know, everything else that moving around. But we've got this other piece of the calcium carbonate, this mineral piece that seems slightly unusual.
Yeah, so this is actually really important. So in seawater, there are ions of calcium dissolved into the seawater. There are also ions of what we call carbonate. But basically, the coral needs both of these, and then it absorbs them, and there's a chemical reaction between the two that forms from something that is just floating about in the water and you couldn't see it, it will form something like this, a coral skeleton. So the mineral that this is made up of is called calcium carbonate. So like I said, it's those calcium ions, those carbonate ions coming together, forming this really rock hard, you can see it's really hard, skeleton. We also have other minerals that are really important. For example, silica, which is what forms glass. Sponges, for example, a lot of their skeleton is made up of little glass pieces. And so they take out silica out of the water. But then we also have all these, what we call organic nutrients, which are used for feeding. So like you said, the nitrates, we have the phosphates, and the coral reef is actually really good at recycling all these nutrients so that multiple users will take advantage of them before they disappear and wash out to the deeper ocean.
I mean, you mentioned that recycling. I mean, we talked earlier about the symbiotic relationship between the algae and the coral polyp. What does the algae get out of this, other than being stuck in a sort of mini upside down jellyfish?
So this has been a question that, you know, it's been really interesting for coral reef scientists to discover, like, why would this little microscopic alga decide to live inside a coral, feeding the coral while it could just feed itself instead of feeding the coral? What does it get back? And so one thing that we have found is given back to the corals are waste products, back to the symbionts, are waste products of the coral itself. These are things like, for example, ammonia. That's a waste product that animals excreted. We do that ourselves, as you all very well know. But the little photosynthetic microorganisms, they need this ammonia. They can use it to continue all the chemical reactions they do during photosynthesis. So instead of being wasted, they take that up. And by living inside a coral, they don't have to worry about getting it from elsewhere. They'll always have it in big abundance.
Amazing, Michelle. We've got some lovely questions coming through, but I just wanted to reiterate this fact that may not be entirely clear to students watching, is that almost coral reefs shouldn't be there. They're sort of oases in a desert. Just in terms of ecosystem functioning, are there other examples of how well or sort of almost uniquely the coral ecosystem sort of functions that it really makes, you know, as much as possible out of what is available?
So yeah, indeed, this was one thing that Darwin himself first noticed. Like, how is it possible that in this crystal clear water, which means that there's really hardly any nutrients in there, how is it that this amazingly biodiverse ecosystem is able to grow? And so there's another important example here is the role of sponges. And so in the water, there are also a lot of dissolved sugars, which for many years we didn't even know they were there. You can't see them. No one had detected them. But we have recently found out that sponges are able to take up these sugars, and then by feeding themselves, they grow their own biomass, and then, you know, turtles can feed on them, fish can feed on them, or when the sponge dies or when it replenishes its own cells, all this gets returned to the ecosystem in a form that all the other animals can also use. So you have this recycling loop there as well.
So maybe we should fight to rename the coral and sponge ecosystem.
Perhaps. I won't go there, but perhaps.
Let's not go there. A whole scientific controversy there. Some questions through. The first question, really interesting and something I've never sort of thought about, is how do sponges and the sponges you have with you, how do they stay stuck to the bottom of the sea?
Yeah, so I don't know, maybe I can show you here. It's not really obvious, but this is another sponge. It's a branching form. So typically down the bottom here, they are attached to the rock they are growing on, or some sponges can even attach into sand. They don't have roots, though, or anything like that, right? So sponges are animals. They're not plants. But they do attach to the bottom through a special layer of cells that they have here.
So, I mean, is it like they have a sort of super glue layer of cells that sort of...
Almost. No, they form a layer which is perhaps a bit sticky, like you say, but it will grow, it will sort of cover the rock, and they'll be firmly anchored there.
Okay.
In saying that, they do, you know, when there is a really big storm or something like that, they can break off. It's not as permanent and as hard as the coral skeletons that we talked about.
Tricky question, maybe, but what is the best coral reef area that you have visited?
I'm a bit biased in this one because I do have a really favourite place, and that is Heron Island on the Great Barrier Reef.
Yep.
You've been there yourself, I believe. So, yeah, that's an amazing place. But it's not only the coral reef, it's the combination. There's so much happening both on land and underwater. It's a really good example of a really healthy ecosystem. And you can also see there really well how what happens on land affects what happens underwater as well. And so to have healthy reefs, we need healthy terrestrial ecosystems as well. But yeah, Heron is just beautiful. We always say on our dives there, don't drop anything because you've lost it forever. There's no way you're going to find it back because the bottom of the sea is just covered with corals. There is nowhere a bare patch with nothing growing.
Amazing. And you mentioned the, and I wish we had more time, but we've got one question I'm going to leave to the end. But very quickly, we've looked at connectivity and interdependence within an ecosystem. Can you talk about the connectivity between ecosystems and how coral is reliant, or the animals that live on coral are reliant on other marine and terrestrial ecosystems?
Yeah, so starting with other marine ecosystems, so there is connectivity between different coral reefs. So for example, if you imagine two islands that are fairly close to each other, the way that corals reproduce allows corals to move from one island to the other, even though, you know, you typically think of them as organisms that can't move, can't go anywhere. But what happens is that when they reproduce, they release little eggs and sperm into the water. These result in little larvae. These larvae can't swim very well, but they can get into ocean currents, which will spread them quite large distances. And so we talk of connectivity between coral ecosystems because of the way that a lot of, and not only corals, a lot of other coral reef organisms reproduce in such ways. We also have connectivity between different aquatic ecosystems, for example, mangroves and coral reefs. A lot of the fish that live on a coral reef, they are born in the mangroves. So the parent fish will lay the eggs there, and then the little eggs, when they are old enough, they will swim back to the reef to live their life there. And then finally, we have the connectivity between the terrestrial ecosystems and the coral reefs. And that's really clearly seen on a day like today here in Curaçao, that the rain is just pouring down. And it's really easy to see how everything from land gets washed into the sea, and on a coral reef, this can be a quite important factor because it changes the water clarity that is so important that we talked about earlier.
And thank you so much for that. I'm just brushing aside because there's one lovely question here, which is, do you have any advice for school leavers interested in becoming a coral scientist?
Yeah, so there I would say that there's no limit to what you can do. So if you want to become a marine biologist and that's your dream, then, you know, it can be done. I always thought it was a really tricky thing to achieve, but, you know, you do need quite some years of studying, so be prepared for that. So you'll typically have to study biology first, so general biology. Then you might have to specialize in marine biology. After that, you'll specialize even further in coral reef ecology. And so you do need quite some years of training, but they are very enjoyable years, I can tell you. And at the end of it, it's really worth it. You will learn so much about the natural world. I find it a really amazing job.
Michelle, a glowing advertisement there for a career in marine science and particularly in coral biology. Thank you so, so much for being part of AXA Coral Live. It's been wonderful having you. And thank you so, so much to all the classes who have been participating too. Don't forget to join us tomorrow and on Thursday for two more sort of expert level live lessons on human activity and then on coral restoration and conservation. It'd be great to have you with us for those. Michelle, thank you again. But for now, it's goodbye from Coral Life. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone.